Hi, my name is Glenn Worthy, and this is Building Legal Literacies for Text Data Mining on the topic of contracts and licenses. In this segment, we'll talk about open and public licenses. Public licenses are boilerplate, a term Kyle introduced you to in an earlier segment, meaning very roughly that they're non-negotiated. These are licenses under which copyright holders may choose to release their works for use by the public without requiring special permission. Probably the most famous public licenses, really a suite of licenses, is the famous Creative Commons. Some people believe that Creative Commons is somehow the opposite of copyright, or that it somehow negates copyright. This is not the case. Copyright is generally automatic as long as a work meets a very few specific criteria. It remains in force until its term ends. But what an open public license does is to provide a mechanism for copyright holders to grant to the public permissions to use her work. The copyright holder relinquishes some of the rights to which copyright law entitles her. It's a license, a contract not to sue, as Kyle taught us, between the copyright holder and the public for particular uses of a work that would otherwise be restricted and violations of which could be litigated. To reiterate what we've learned in previous segments, licenses and other contracts operate in a separate legal realm from copyright. They don't undo or modify copyright, but rather in an interesting sort of turnabout, they actually rely on the copyright holder's exclusive economic and moral rights in order to do something interesting with their works. For example, to choose not to make money from their creations, or to choose not to prevent redistribution or derivative works. Most of these licenses do, in fact, preserve some of the rights granted by copyright law. For example, the copyright-enabled moral right to be identified as an author of a particular work. The world of public licenses is immense. Even an important subset of that world, the realm of open licenses, is immense. This chart illustrates the tremendous variety of the network of open licenses and a sort of genealogy and chronology of their development. We won't spend much time on their myriad flavors and nuances, but let's talk briefly about a few of them, starting with the example of the very image you're looking at. This illustration is a copyrighted work. It has an author, Christina Bocan, who holds the copyright to her creation, but she has granted to the public a license to use it, and look how helpfully she's done so, highlighting in a broken green outline the specific license she's chosen for it. It is under these terms that she is allowing me and you to use her work. This license is her contract not to sue me for reusing her work without my even asking her, and it's my contract with her to acknowledge her moral and legal rights as its creator. I do this by including her name on the slide. These two agreements represent the totality of our mutual agreement. We didn't negotiate it. She set the terms herself, and I accepted them by using her image in this presentation. With this interaction, our contract is settled and enforceable. Christina can't take away my right to use her cool chart, and I'm obliged always to give her credit for it, which of course, as a responsible scholar, I would always do anyway. Let's focus briefly on one corner of this chart, highlighting one family of licenses sometimes called copyleft. I suspect that most of us can decipher many of the words denoting the licenses you see here, maybe in decreasing order of decipherability. Python, the programming language, Apache, the software that runs most of the world's web servers, and W3C, the World Wide Web Consortium. MIT stands precisely for the great university you probably think it stands for. And the B in BSD stands for our institute's host and my alma mater, UC Berkeley. The SD in BSD stands for software distribution, which is the key to what unites these open licenses. They're all generally used for software, as you might have guessed. By the way, GPL here stands for the general public license of the Free Software Foundation's GNU project. And GNU stands recursively for GNU's not Unix. In addition to the self-referential GNU acronym, which may be somewhere on your cutesy to annoying spectrum, but I like it. Note also the hard to translate pun implied in the term copyleft, which implies that it's the opposite of copyright. In fact, once again, it's not. It's just a license, very much dependent on copyright law, as we've heard. A creator's exclusive right to define and determine the terms of use for her creation, even those very permissive terms, is the product of copyright, even when her intent is to manipulate and in many respects undo many of those terms. Software licenses are pretty much like the licenses for other kinds of content, such as texts and image. But one of the distinguishing features of the copyleft licenses is that they tend to include terms that explicitly allow derivative works and that require those derivative works to be distributed with the same share-alike terms, which makes some sense given their origins. It was precisely the peculiarities of working with software that inspired this particular community to be so activist in creating and promoting open licenses in the late 1970s and 1980s. Unlike a book or a record, software sort of begs to be tinkered with, debugged, modified, copied, and so forth. And the copyright regime, together with the restrictive licenses that made billionaires out of many copyright holders, were an impediment. But maybe I shouldn't have said that software is unlike a book or record in its desire to be modified and remixed. One of the hallmarks of the next major phase of open licensing, Creative Commons, is the idea of remix culture of the 1990s and 2000s, and trumpeted by the founder of Creative Commons himself, Lawrence Lessig. That's our next topic. Lessig created and began promoting these licenses through the Creative Commons Foundation just over 20 years ago. He's written prolifically and, in my opinion, highly readably about the origins and philosophy of Creative Commons, its particular importance in the internet era, about remix culture and free culture, and other aspects of this contract-turned movement that we don't have time to cover. But it's interesting and important work, even for non-lawyers. Maybe especially for non-lawyers. In practical terms, Creative Commons licenses have a veritable smorgasbord of options that modify the blanket permissions granted by the licensor, that is, the copyright holder. These options can include the requirement that every use be accompanied by an attribution, as with CC BY, or that only non-commercial uses are allowed, or that derivative works are not allowed, such as translations, and a number of others. Strictly speaking, because of the possibility of these restrictions, the licenses are sometimes considered by some people not to be open. For me, that interpretation is a little too fundamentalist. The licenses are specifically designed to make copyright-protected content more open, even if that openness has terms attached to it. Even more importantly, these licenses are open because, by their design, any use not strictly prohibited is actually allowed. No questions asked, no lawsuits threatened, no money changing hands. Thinking back to Christina Bocan's helpful whiteboard chart, has she granted me any other permissions with her CC BY license? Certainly. With this license, I can not only use her image in this presentation, I could also include it in a publication of my own without asking. I could even just republish and redistribute it by myself without adding anything of my own. Likewise, Christina is allowing me to translate her chart into another language, or set it to music, or use it in a collage. But if she had chosen a Creative Commons no derivatives license, I would not have had the right to do those things. Could I put it on a bunch of t-shirts and coffee mugs and sell them? Absolutely. Do I have to ask her permission? Would I owe her any royalties? No. She's already decided this question just by choosing this license. And if Christina were opposed to that sort of thing, and many reasonable people might be, she could simply have chosen a Creative Commons non-commercial license or non-derivative license and refused to have her creativity feed my crass commercialism, but she didn't do that. What do open licenses have to do with text data mining? Like any other contract, these licenses imply at least two parties, a licensor and a licensee, and people in our TDM community, whether as librarians or other practitioners, have opportunities to act in both roles. So far, we've mainly discussed the licensee role, what we're allowed or not allowed to do with materials that have some sort of open license attached to them. But it's also critical to understand that we ourselves are often creators, thus copyright holders, and therefore that we also have the right to determine the license and the terms under which we allow our work to be used. I'm sure it won't surprise anyone here that I encourage you, to the extent possible, to choose open licenses. Our libraries can and should do this with research materials that we create, and scholars can do the same. Let's look briefly at an example I'm especially fond of. It's from my employer, the HathiTrust Research Center. But since I didn't work there when they made this excellent set of decisions, I don't mind bragging about it a little. The extracted features dataset is a staple of TDM work. But here's a remarkable thing. It doesn't contain text as we normally define it. Instead, it consists solely of metadata about the texts contained in the enormous HathiTrust digital library, all 17 plus million volumes of them, including, as you see here, if the print's not too small, a substantial number of in-copyright books. This metadata naturally includes descriptions of each book, like any library catalog. But much more significantly, and radically and intelligently in my view, is that it includes metadata about each page, each line, each word, and each letter and number in those texts. This is what text miners need to do their work. Even though many uses of the books thus described may be restricted by copyright, because this metadata contains only facts about these texts, it is not a violation of copyright for us to extract them or to share them with others. In fact, as we've already heard, hopefully more than once, but it always bears repeating, the courts have found that precisely this sort of use is a fair use. But this database itself is a compilation with particular arrangement, an apparatus, documentation, all of which we've devised ourselves, is our creation, and thus we become the holders of its copyright. And we could, in theory, claim all sorts of rights for ourselves and restrictions for other people. But of course we don't do that. In order to promote its adoption and use and reuse and experimentation and so forth, we've published it under a Creative Commons license. This for me is sort of like magic. We've turned massive numbers of restricted, or at the very least ambiguously protected, texts into free and open research materials. And then, of course, we've shared that treasure by being free and open with these materials ourselves. This is not some legal loophole, but rather a solid understanding of the law. Amazing, isn't it? I'll leave you with this thought for now and hope it sustains you a little as we broach a murkier topic in our next segment, library licenses for electronic resources.